without further ado, we now start with the keynote lecture. I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker. Ms. Anna Oposa is the Executive Director and Chief Mermaid of Save Philippine Seas, or SPS, a movement to protect the Philippine marine resources by mobilizing citizens, no, not just citizens, but citizens, toward collective action and behavior change. Under her leadership, SPS has created two innovative and results-oriented environmental education programs. The Sea and Earth Advocates Camp develops youth leaders to be leaders in conservation, earth education, building the capacity of leaders in conservation. The other program is Earth Education, which builds the capacity of teachers to teach environmental education. Aspects of these programs were pioneered or piloted in Timor-Leste, Papua New Guinea, and Solomon Islands in 2018. Anna graduated with a BA in English Studies from the University of the Philippines, cum laude, and she obtained her Master of Science in Conservation Science from the Imperial College of London through the Chevening Scholarship. She co-wrote an introduction to climate change for Filipino youth and edited the 2020 Conservation Roadmap for Sharks and Rays in the Philippines. She co-wrote the Shark Conservation Legislation, a toolkit for Philippine policymakers, and her work has been recognized locally and internationally, and she has received many awards, including the Yahoo Southeast Asia's 7 Inspiring Modern Day Filipino Heroes, the youngest and only Filipino recipient of the Future for Nature Award, and so on. Ladies and gentlemen, Anna is just entering our meeting room. I saw a sign. May I introduce to you our keynote speaker, Ms. Anna Oposa. Chris, is Anna in the room already?
Yes, Anna's preparing.
Okay. So maybe while Anna is preparing, you know, in addition to her long-term commitment to marine conservation, Anna is also deeply passionate about the correct use of punctuation marks. And she loves wearing sunscreen every day, probably because she's always in the sea, and she loves lipsticks. We'll see what shade she's wearing today.
Hi.
Hi.
I'm here. Hi everyone, good morning. I'm Anna Oposa. I'm the Executive Director and Chief Mermaid of Save Philippine Seas, and I'm honored to be your keynote speaker today. This has been moved several times, so I'm really glad that I'm able to join you and that you are able to join this conversation today. So I will be talking about how to turn earth education into edu-action. So first I need to backtrack and tell you a little bit about how Save Philippine Seas started. In 2011, it actually began as a social media campaign with the hashtag SavePHSeas. And back then, I had just graduated college. I had no plans of going into environmental conservation. So I was doing it as a side hustle while I looked for a job. But then it evolved and became a non-profit organization in 2018. And Save Philippines now has three focus areas. One is to engage with governments, businesses, and kind of institutions. Another one is to educate, and that's, I guess, why I'm invited here to talk about how we conduct environmental education programs across the Philippines and the region. But most of all, we are most passionate about empowerment. And what we really want people to feel is that when they leave a Save Philippine Seas program, they're more confident to fulfill or address their purpose in addressing environmental issues. So for the next maybe 10 minutes or so, I'm going to share with you some lessons that we've learned in our advocacy as we've been doing this for 9 years. So we're actually turning 10 next year. So first is you have to use your imagination. So Save Philippine Seas is actually a really small organization. We are about, for a long time, SPS was actually a one-woman show, but now we're 3 to 4, depending on what project we're working on. So we never really have a lot of money, but it's the lack of resources that have made us very resourceful. So my background is actually in theater. And when I was performing, our directors would always say, the motto when putting up a show is to beg, borrow, and steal. And well, not naman steal, but this has been a guiding motto for us to make sure that we maximize every single peso that is donated to Save Philippine Seas. So one of the ways that we've really maximized free resources is social media. If you are familiar, if you're Filipino, you will know that the Philippines has been called the social media capital of the world. So the average time that the Filipino spends online is more than any other nationality in the world. So we've harnessed this by riding on different pop culture trends. For example, when Pokemon Go was really popular, we rode on this wave and we created a Thresher Shark campaign for an illegal wildlife trade campaign in 2016. We also want to change the way we approach environmentalism and be open with things that are difficult for us. So we've created the Eco Guilt campaign where we're allowed to talk about the things that are hard for us to change. And I think it's important to acknowledge that, you know, having an environmental lifestyle is a journey, and we have to aim for progress and not perfection. If you are Filipino, you'll also know that Filipinos are very romantic. So we wanted to capitalize on this, and we created a waste-free wedding guide, which is available for brides or aspiring brides and grooms, and that all these resources are free in our website. So another thing is to cultivate appreciation. It's surprising and also sad that a lot of our participants have actually never been in the ocean. You know, 70 to 90% of our participants are participating in an environmental event for the first time or going into the water for the first time. And we do this by taking people out. And we feel that, you know, it's one thing to be able to see the sea in documentaries, but a completely different thing to actually be in the ocean and experience what it's like to be near corals and have fish swim around you. So we make sure that we teach them basic safety, you know, protocols, and then take them inside the water. And off the water, I mean, when we're not in the water, then we find other ways to bring the ocean to children and to, especially to the youth. Because youth matter. And as someone who, I started out in environmental trainings and workshops because my dad is an environmental lawyer. So I grew up really exposed to different issues. And what I've learned in this life is that a lot of environmental education programs see youth as passive participants. And this became my frustration. You know, I attended different kinds of environmental education programs, and all I did was to sit in the audience, take notes, you know, participate in some workshops. So in 2015, I had the opportunity to create my own environmental education program with the support of the US Embassy, and it's called the Sea Camp. And what I wanted to do differently was to really give agency and responsibility to our youth participants. They're 18 to 24 years old. And we take them out, we take them to different outdoor activities, we expose them to different communities that are engaged in tourism, enforcement, waste management, to see what it's like on the ground. And the most unique thing about our Sea Camp is at the end of the week, they actually have to do projects in the community, whether it's convincing business owners to stop using single-use plastics or create an environmental compliance assessment through our environmental laws. And this gives them an opportunity to really apply what they've learned and not just let it stay in their heads. And we're also very particular about monitoring and evaluation. So during my master's, my thesis was actually on how we have to improve our monitoring and evaluation methods as environmental educators, because what you can measure, you can manage. And with our, so we have a pre-test, we have a post-test, we have a delayed post-test, which we administer 3 months after and 1 year after to track if our programs are really effective in reaching our objectives. And with this kind of data, I can say with confidence, with statistical confidence, that youth are not just leaders of tomorrow, but we're also leaders of today. And we can say that confidently if we are given the right opportunities and the right skills to back them up. So some of the things that we worked on are Waste Watchers, which is a campaign to reduce single-use plastics. And this kind of toolkit is one way that we can turn education into edu-action. So these are some of the campaigns. We have Straw Wars, which has been replicated in Borneo and in Malaysia. Defying Gravity is on balloons and lanterns so that people don't release them. And it became really popular because of Rapunzel, I think, in Tangled. We also have Plastic Battle, which is on reducing plastic bottles. And all of our materials can be found in our website, safephilippinesseas.org. If you look at the resources, so the third bar in this screen, we have our toolkits, our letters to leaders, and infographics, and all our materials are in our website for free and open source because we don't want any barriers for people to turn their education into action. So if you click on one of our toolkits, this is what it looks like. We imagine, you know, I think about what I was like when I was 18, wanting to create a campaign. And we really believe in not preaching to the choir, but building the choir. So one of our questions always when we create an environmental education is how do we reach people who are kind of interested in environmental conservation, but they don't really know where to start. So we've done Zumba for the sharks with the mommies and titas of the Magete. We've created workshops in breweries and tap rooms so you can, you know, have fun. And it doesn't make environmental education so intimidating, and always come from a place of collaboration or collaboration. We love to work with different kinds of organizations and people. I always joke that SPS is like, it's like Switzerland. It's the neutral territory, and we are open to working with different kinds of organizations. Now that we can't travel, you know, pre-pandemic, we would be out traveling every month, different parts of the Philippines. So it's been quite an adjustment in terms of lifestyle and approach now that we're all working from home. So what we've done is, so the first few months we were kind of finding our footing, I guess, as with everybody, but we decided to just kind of listen to what people were saying, people were asking, and we created a set of infographics called Plastics in the Pandemic, Facts versus Fears. And it took us quite a while to publish this because we wanted to make sure that our science was up to date. So this is also available on Save Philippine Seas. And we created the Reusers Manual and just some small tips that citizens, we call our followers citizens, that our citizens can do to reduce plastics at a time like this. This is actually going to be published in a mall, in a popular mall in the Philippines. So they've partnered with us. Another thing that we're working on is earth education. And I hope that, you know, people listening will be able, we can partner with you somehow. We're creating a manual, which is, you know, like steps on how to reduce waste and promote environmental conservation in your school, but also now at home. It comes with an activity guide for elementary and high school students of interactive activities that you can do, again, in school or at home. And a starter pack where the materials in the activity guide will be put together in a kit. This is still in the process, and we're actually looking for people who can test it out, people who can give us feedback. So do get in touch if this is something that you're interested to work on. And we're really hungry for improvement and feedback. So I hope to hear from some of you. We're also working on a climate change campaign. This climate change campaign just happened out of kind of out of a whim. And we thought, what if we try to do something on climate change? And climate change communication, as you probably already know, is very challenging. And this has been a big comms challenge for us. So we've created a campaign called Change the Current. It means different things. You know, we want to turn the tide. We want to change how we're looking at climate change into something more understandable, something more localized. So we just started rolling it out, and we have a lot of other things in plan in our plans as we unfold this climate change campaign. So we try to make it as simple as possible. And it's a challenge between wanting to make things simple but not dumbing things down. And most of all, it's important to have fun. Sometimes environmental education can be really, environmental conservation as a field can be depressing, but we take problems of the ocean seriously, but we don't take ourselves seriously. We always have a lot of fun. We find ways to laugh. We find ways to make our campaigns engaging. This is one of my favorite photos. We were campaigning on sharks and we used the song Baby Shark over and over and over again. And we, you know, made these mascots walk around Manila. And as environmental educators, I think my most important lesson is to always be the star student. So growing up, I was, you know, I guess I was one of those teacher's pets who would always, you know, sit in the front row and do well in school in terms of, you know, grades and assignments. But I think it's really more about my love for learning that drove my academic curiosity. I've always been curious. I've always been asking questions because there's just so much about the world that we have to learn, no matter how many PhDs and how many degrees and how many papers we've published. And I think I am the number one student of my own students, and I'm sure a lot of you feel the same way as well. I'm going to close with just a couple of more slides, just to say that it's so important to have hope in humanity. Sometimes it's hard to have hope because of all the things, of all the negativity that we hear every day, but Mariah Carey and Whitney Houston have said wisely that though hope is frail, it's hard to kill. And that's something that I've always held on to. Gloria Steinem says that hope is a strategy. It's the way that we are able to move forward. And I invite everyone to make waves and really use this time and use this opportunity to network with other people. And maybe together we can make waves. So thank you for having me and good morning. These are our contacts.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Anna. You know, we don't have questions yet, but can I just comment? I really love the play of language and words that you have. You know, from Straw Wars instead of Star Wars, or plastic battle instead of plastic bottles. It's a bit hard if you know how to say the words correctly. And I think when you hesitate because you're pronouncing it the wrong way, from knee shore instead of measure, it's brilliant. It's so funny, actually.
You know what? I'm an English major, so I majored in English. And I think this is the way that my education has creeped into my advocacy.
Yeah, it really, it has an impact. Like I'm just saying it when I was reading your intro, saying citizens was difficult as well as, you know, seriously, you know, like humanity. That's wonderful. If you could tell how creative, so much creative input went into, and it does look like fun. I wonder if there are questions from our audience or if we'd just like to have a conversation or just to give feedback to Anna. We do have time because it's only 9:33. So if anybody wants to speak up, just let me know, or you can type in the chat box. Or maybe, Anna, you could share with us, how has this week been for you, given what we just had in this country? What is that like when there is like a calamity or a disaster? How does SPS respond?
Yeah, this is a really good question and something that I've been thinking about. So there are several partners who have reached out to say, like, is SPS doing aid, like, you know, fundraising for aid agencies? And I said no, because we want to focus on what we're good at, which is environmental education. I think we have to know when to stay in our lane, but also, you know, in terms of environmental education and fundraising, there are people who are good at immediate needs and mobilizing resources for immediate needs. And then I think SPS falls more into the long-term, slow but steady fundraising arm. And what the recent events have sparked in us is the bigger conversation about the climate emergency. So we're actually working with the Department of Education. We're working with other NGOs to see how we can react to the climate emergency on a longer and more sustainable term by creating modules, creating training materials specifically for the Filipino audience, because I think this is something that we have a lot of room for improvement for.
You know, part of my introduction to you talked about how you pioneered or pilot tested your projects outside the Philippines. I respond to this very well because of my language background. But when you were doing it in Timor-Leste, how did you play around with words in the same way? Was language an issue as you go to another country? Because it's something we have to deal with in Southeast Asia always, right?
Yeah.
It's a language thing. Yeah.
So obviously my puns did not fly. I mean, it's you know, I had to drop them, but the values and the ideas behind the workshops are similar. So I think it did well because the way we create workshops is always interactive. You know, we teach marine protected areas through role play, through games, and we borrow different elements from different games that we already know. And for a lot of the places that I worked in Timor-Leste, in Papua New Guinea, and in Solomon Islands, it was their first time to be part of an environmental workshop. So it was great. It was challenging because I would train the local team and they would carry it out in their local language. So in my head, I'm just hoping, I hope I was an effective educator and I was able to teach them the right things. Yeah, but it was great.
Okay, so there's a question here from Dream Academy. It's a YouTube question. It's from our live stream. Really amazing and so engaging, Miss Anna. Of course, I can see that they also had a lot of fun with your words. But you mentioned earlier that you try to make it fun. You know, there was a focus group discussion. One of the theses done by an Ateneo student was to ask students how they felt with environmental campaigns. And there seemed to be some kind of fatigue when it comes to, you know, guilt fatigue when you're yes. being told. Yeah. So how do you make the balance between, how do you achieve balance between seriousness and gravity of the situation while also making it fun without them dismissing it as something that is not, you know, important or serious? You know?
That's a great question. I think it's hard, you know, and it's always the case-to-case basis because you have to find the right balance between making people feel empowered, but also pushing people to do a bit more. And the way that we've done it is we don't capitalize on the doom and gloom of environmental conservation because I feel like so many other organizations do that well. Media does it well. It's always like people dying and people, you know, corals will die by this time. And at some point, I think people shut off when they hear a lot of bad news. And I shut off, you know, I stopped reading the news at some point because I just felt like, okay, another day of bad news. So how do we take that bad news and create opportunities for people to act? So if people, you know, if for example, just a simple example, there was that viral video of the turtle with a straw in its nose. And instead of showing that again and again, like, okay, we get it, you know, we decided to create straw wars as a response to that. And really work with cafes, restaurants, and give them options. It wasn't like, okay, by tomorrow, you're not gonna use straws. It's, okay, are you able to reduce straws for 2 days in a week? Are you able to just offer straws upon request, like if the customer asks for it? So by default, you don't. So it's about finding those pockets of empowerment and action so that people don't feel fatigued. Because people also want to win, right? They also want to feel that there are ways for them to take action.
So we have some positive feedback also. So this is from Paring Bert. Okay, he says, Anna, thank you for your advocacy and imagination. We can push for education for classmate change. Do you, you said earlier that you measure, you measured a lot of things that make you confidently say that it's not just for the future, but at present, the youth are already leading. Can you share some of those things that give you statistical confidence? You know, some of those things you've measured.
For our C-CAMPS, for our environmental education program, we have a pre-test, so day one, and then we have a post-test, day seven. And we broke it down into environmental knowledge, environmental behavior, what are the environmental behaviors that you practice every day now. And then we also measure social civic attitudes. So do you feel like you vote? I mean, do you feel like you want the vote? Do you feel confident in, you know, things like this? And then we track it on day seven, but not environmental behavior. We track environmental behavior 3 months after, and then a year after, we kind of chase them and say, hey, since the C-CAMP has your behavior sustained, so we tabulate that. And you know, during my master's, when I was in college in UP, I never took a single math class. I survived by not taking a single math class because numbers give me anxiety. And during my master's, I had to learn how to do statistics. And even if it was super simple statistics like t-tests and stuff, I started crying because I was like, oh my God, this is so hard. I had to learn how to do those mga R, mga ganyan. But kaya naman pala, you can do it with Excel. So I've calmed down and I know how to do basic stats. So we take the scores from the pre-test, the post-test, the late post-test, and we're able to say, you know, with statistic confidence that our programs are effective in terms of reaching the objectives to increase environmental behavior, awareness, and social civic attitudes. We also have qualitative assessments. So we have focus group discussions, we have interviews, we have observations to also support quantitative data.
Okay, so we're going to do one last round of calls. If you have final feedback or questions, please type them in the chat box. And maybe, Anna, you could think of a final parting message to our Southeast Asian audience and also nationwide. We have people from everywhere. I think there's over 100 people already in the live stream that's watching us from all sorts of places. Maybe if you have, you know, final words of advice on cultivating an ecological mindset, or people here are have their own programs in their own universities. How can we save the seas, or how can we do more advocacy work? Although, wait, there is, what advice? I will read it. No, this was given to me in private. What advice would you give to educators in making workshops or classes as interactive in an online setting as they might be in an in-person setting?
That's a question I've also been asking myself and our team. But one of the ways that we've, I think one lesson that I've learned is to accept, and this is really, really hard for me to accept, that whatever we do in person cannot be replicated in an online setting. I think, you know, for the first 6 months, I was in denial that this is going to be our life for the next, I don't know how long. But when I finally accepted that, I was like, okay, then what are the elements of an in-person event that I can replicate online? So it's creating interactive activities online, group works, discussions, and make sure that it's not a one-way activity. Another thing that I learned is to give them assignments that they can do in their own home. So for example, like energy efficiency, you make them take their electric bill for 1 month and then tell them to do certain things like, you know, unplug appliances or switch their bulbs or something, and then measure it at the end after a month to see if there's any difference. So it's finding those opportunities to engage them in things that they can do from home. But I'm also, of course, open to suggestions, and if anyone wants to reach out and give ideas, please do so.
And so with that, I think it's a good way to end with advice from our chief mermaid. I'm telling, thank you very much for all those practical, inspiring, measurable things that you have shared with us this morning. Are you wearing lipstick?
I got a nude color because it's red, so I didn't want to be like red, you know.
Hey, that's part of the fun way she introduced herself. She says she loves wearing lipstick. Thank you very much to our chief mermaid.
Thank you, Anna Oposa. Congratulations for finally getting this through. I'm really excited for this.
When nagpahabol last minute, before we say goodbye, we do still have time. Somebody asked humbly for pahabol if the organization, I think that's your organization, would also consider to have any program with regards to some factors that can affect marine wildlife, like coral acidification, species, or overfishing.
We do have programs for. We have some materials that we've created. Actually, a friend of mine who's a teacher just actually reached out and said, can we use those materials? So we have infographics and other materials. And if you look at our Instagram, SafePHCs, anything you find there, it's open source and you're able to use that. So please feel free to explore it. And if you want like high-res images, just send us a message and we'll share the files with you.
How can they access your presentation? And daming pahabol. Your idea of how to conduct workshops is so practical. How can we access this particular presentation?
I've given a copy to the secretariat, so you know they're free to share that with you anytime.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Oh, that's a good last. If we are not from the Philippines, so this is a question from one of our foreign participants. Can we get involved in your organization? So I guess. How can we help? How can we be part of what you're doing?
Yeah, so we actually have, we're announcing it next month and in January. We have two Southeast Asian programs that we are going to open to the region, including Timor-Leste. It's called the Marine, well, we haven't finalized the name because I'm running out of puns. An accelerator program for marine projects, so stay tuned for that. And then we've done sea camps on a regional basis, so we've had 10 all 10 ASEAN member countries, participants from all 10 ASEAN member countries. So we are expanding. It's just unfortunate that our name is not unfortunate, but we started out with Save Philippine Seas, and then now we're realizing that we actually have, you know, opportunities to scale on a regional level, but don't feel limited that just because our name has Philippines, it doesn't mean that we're only working in the Philippines. We have started branching out into regional activities. So if you want to replicate any of our campaigns, any of our projects, then please get in touch, because what we've done in the past is, for example, Straw Wars Philippines, we just edited out Philippines and we put Malaysia, we put Borneo. Here's some things that we've done in the past and are very open to do it again.
Okay, so good luck with your accelerator program.
You just gave me an idea.
Okay, so thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Anna.
This has been a fun morning. Your ray of sunshine. Sorry, the gray then. You're a ray of sunshine and a chief mermaid, everybody, in a digital fashion. I mean, in a virtual way. Let us give a big round of applause to our keynote speaker.
Thank you.
Very young and fresh and brilliant, Anna Oposa. Thank you, Anna.